Okay.
All right. Hello, everyone. Welcome to the online Gokova Geometry Topology Institute seminars. Today, our speaker is Grigory Mikalkin, and he's going to tell us about area considerations in real algebraic geometry.
Okay. Thank you very much. So it's, of course, a great pleasure to speak in the Gokova mini-series lectures, but it's a serious pity that it's not in person in Gokova. So this is first out of four lectures joint with Ilya. So the idea is to just to make a very elementary mini course on real algebraic curves, primarily, maybe a little bit about surfaces, but the main object are just real algebraic curves, where the main aspect which we will be studying area, and would like to make it as interactive as possible. So please interrupt many times. And also, there are many things which can be said around those area considerations, from very classical to very recent, and we're thinking of kind of combining very classical and very real in there. So please interrupt me at any time. And of course, if we try to start with classical consideration, probably the most famous formula for the area is the formula for the area of our disk, right? The area of the region bounded by a circle, right? So we know that if we consider a circle, right, then if it's a circle of radius r, then the area is pi r square. And of course, the circle is an algebraic curve, right? We can write it as x square plus y square is equal to r square. We can also look at another algebraic curve, kind of an ellipse. Right? For an ellipse, we also have easy formula in terms of its half axis, right? So if we have those a and b, we have a similar formula, pi ab. This is also an algebraic curve, also given by some f of xy, where f is some quadratic equation. Okay, so these are the simplest things we have to look inside of area, but also we do know that, so what if F is any polynomial equation, any polynomial in X and Y? In X and Y into polynomials, even if degree is two, right? It has the degree, so the degree is two, and then these are almost all curves which we have, except for then, of course, we have the hyperbola, right? So sometimes we can also get such an equation which would parameterize a hyperbola, also a parabola, and all of these have a parabola. Another important curve is the empty set, right? It's also can be given by an equation of degree two. And these are all, so an ellipse, which we already considered, right? These are all possible non-singular curves, all possible smooth curves of degree two. And actually, in the case of degree two curves, we know that if it has a singularity, it has to be a union of two lines. Those two lines can be real, those two lines can be complex, and so on. From what we see here is that actually three out of four cases, right, they are the same. So those three cases are the same after projectivization. Same once we projectivize, and projectivize just means that we embed our R2, right? So our curves were inside of R2, we just embed them inside of RK2. Of course, to embed it to RK2, just add one line. Add one line, which we call the absolute. And as a result, we just have a single curve, which is an ellipse, right? And then the difference of those curves just becomes whether those line, which is the absolute, is disjoint from this ellipse, tangent to the ellipse, or intersects the ellipse, right? So kind of we may pass from, so in other words, this is passage from affine considerations to projective configuration. Okay, and when we have this passage, we have simplification, which is kind of clearly viewed in the case of degree two curves, right? We have the single non-singular curves if it's non-empty, and so on. And actually, those. So let us simplify. So in what? So now let's fix considerations. Let us fix our fix P2. This RP2 for the ambient space of our curves. And then, of course, we can use the f of xy equals to zero in affine coordinates. This is the same as writing homogeneous coordinates f of zero y x0, x1, x2 in homogeneous coordinates equal to zero. And then we will just need to write the homogeneous polynomial. So there would be still all polynomials, right? Those are polynomials of degree d, either non-homogeneous of degree d or homogeneous of degree d, but in three variables. And they will give, so each such curve, so we fix d, and then ask for a possible picture for the topological type. The topological type of the pair RP2 and our curve RC, where just RC is the, by definition, the zero set of this polynomial of fx0, x1, x2 equal to zero, where x1, x0, x1, x2 are just homogeneous coordinates inside of this RP2. Right? So as we've already seen, if d is equal to zero, then if I just think of my RP2 as this plane where the opposite sides are glued together, where those antipodal directions are glued, then we have this ellipse, right? So since I don't choose the absolute where to remove it, then but we just have the single, it's of course not zero, but two, and so on. And then there is the long list of curves, d equal to three, the case which was considered by Newton in particular. There are two possibilities. We may have this oval. This is one possibility, and another one are the two things. And in general, the question, which is now known as the Hilbert 16th problem,
did you just say one oval, second possibility?
The only thing, you're right, of course, it's not oval, but the kind of pseudo line. Thanks. So, topologically, right, because we're looking at the configuration of the curve inside of RP2, right, it may look like an oval, in the meaning bouncy disk, it may be homologically non-trivial to be isotopic to RP1. In the case of a cubic, it has to be, actually in any odd degree case, it has to be one kind of solid line component, and then some number of ovals. And then Hilbert's 16th problem was just give the complete classification. The complete classification in terms of D. And this problem grew from the foundational work of Harnack. So the foundational work of Harnack. So it, before Hilbert, that was the work of Axel Harnack, which said that the number of components is always bounded by d minus 1, d minus 2 over 2 plus 1. And furthermore, so this was the inequality proved by Harnack in 1876. And in the same year, there was a, in the same journal, in Mathematische Annalen in 1876, there was a paper of Felix Klein, who was the advisor of Harnack, and who kind of turned the attention that this is the genus of the corresponding complex curve. So whenever we have the equation f of x, y equals to zero, right, we can solve it over real numbers and give some one-dimensional real manifold, but we can also look at all possible complex solutions and get a curve inside of C2. And then if it is non-singular, if it is smooth, then the genus of this curve by the adjunction formula is precisely this d minus 1 times d minus 2 over 2. And Klein gave another proof of Harnack's inequality, which kind of just deduced it from the genus of the corresponding complex surface. And then actually, so this was the great advantage in the end of the 19th century, was kind of postulated so by the time of Hilbert. The classification, by the time of Hilbert was known, let's say, to Hilbert. For d equals to 5 or less, because actually there are not too much things how we can combine those ovals, and d equal to 6 was a special case which he included to that famous list of 23 problems for the next century, and so on. So, and actually, d equals to 6 was only proved, was classification was obtained after this kind of new breakthrough by Gutkov, Arnold and Rochlin. Already in the beginning of 70s, around 1971, something like this. So almost 100 years after Harnack, then it turned out, and actually this is kind of probably one of the best classifications. So if we restrict the degree to 6 and look at maximal number of components, look at this. Look at curves. With the maximal number of components allowed by the Harnack inequality. Look at smooth curves with these things. So by Harnack inequality, d minus 1 times d minus 2 over 2 plus 1 components, which we know is maximal thanks to this Harnack chain inequality. Those curves are called, those maximal curves are called M curves. And as it was shown by Gutkov and verified by Arnold and Rochlin, there was just three possibilities. So if d is equal to 6, then we have 11 components. And we have the curve, which topologically looks like this. And this is the curve which was constructed by Harnack. There is the curve which was constructed by Hilbert, and it contains 9 ovals inside of one of the oval and one outside. And finally, there was a new curve constructed by Gutkov almost 100 years after the construction of the previous two. And so it was constructed by Gutkov. And kind of no other configurations are possible. No other configurations exist. So that was another huge advance. So Arnold and Rochlin related this classification to smooth four-dimensional topology, to Rochlin's theorem on divisibility of signature by 16. So there was a relation to four-dimensional topology. And then kind of the current state of the subject is that d is equal to 7 is classified by zero. After that, so it was around 80s. And for this,
that there are no other configurations exist in the equal to 6 case.
If we use 11, so if we have 11 components, then no other classification exists. There was a proof, so initial proof is due to Gutkov. But there was, there were some, so he was using the method of Hilbert Rowan. There were some gaps, some mistakes found and so on. But once there was the relation, so here I kind of quote Gutkov, Arnold and Rochlin, because Arnold and Rochlin introduced four-dimensional techniques to this problem, and then it was an easier to see that it was much simpler to deduce that nothing else exists. Actually, the main problem was with the Gutkov curve itself. So I think from what I understand, it maybe first he proved that it doesn't exist, and then it constructed it. Am I correct, Ilya?
Yes. First he proved that it doesn't exist, and then he corrected the mistake and he constructed this curve.
So essentially the theorem is due to Gutkov. So I think one can say that it is to Gutkov, but Gutkov was using deformation of curves where it was kind of a long proof where it was easy to make mistakes. And after introduction of four-dimensional technique of Arnold and Rochlin, this is something which we can easily see.
Grisha, I have a stupid question. What is the difference between the Harnack and the Hilbert picture? So in RP2, there is no inside and outside, no?
There is, right? Because let's recall that if we have a circle inside of RP2, it's bounds a disk. Interior is a disk, but exterior is the Möbius band, right? It's the non-oriented.
Ah, okay, it's really a disk. Yeah, okay. Yeah. Thanks. Good.
Mm-hmm. So, but you're completely right. They look very similar, and it's clear that it's not a coincidence that they're. And actually, if we go to this four-dimensional technology, then there would be some symmetry between those two things, but at least explicitly these are different things because they are not homeomorphic aspects. Okay, so the current state d equal to 7 was completely classified by Vero, and for d equal to 7, it was the most difficult part was, so he constructed many curves, and the construction, so for this, so it was the new powerful technique introduced for this d equal to 7, there was this patchworking technique. So Vero and this patchworking as the new construction technique, which later gave birth to tropical geometry. Then there is something which is related to many other things as the new construction technique. And maybe I should say that d equal to 8 is something like almost classified by Arevkov, and by almost classified, I mean that this almost meaning that it is classified in the case when our curves are slightly more flexible, if they are kind of pseudo holomorphic curves, if they are symplectic and invariant with respect. So if instead of algebraic curves are given by equation, right? The equation gives us a curve inside of the real plane, but it also gives, its complex solution gives Riemann surface inside of the complex plane. So instead of this Riemann surface, we can consider just a symplectic surface inside of the complex plane, and then just look how this, ask that this symplectic curve is invariant with respect to the involution of the conjugation, and look what is its possible intersection with the real plane. So then kind of this classification was obtained by Arevkov. And also kind of if we, so this almost means done in the symplectic setting.
In fact, only for maximal curves.
For maximal curves, yeah. But here I'm kind of, I've already kind of restricted to the maximal. Okay, so maybe since I'm restricting myself to maximal case, maybe I can also give the complete classification for d equal to 7 case, the Vero classification, right? The next triangular number after 10 is 15, right? So in degree 7, then we have a pseudo line, right? And then we have 15 ovals, right? And since the degree is 7, we know that if we have a nest, if one oval is inside of another oval, then this nest has to be unique if we have 15 ovals. There is an exception, but this just means that those 15 ovals, they have to be arranged in the following way, that we have one oval and some number of ovals inside, let's say A, and some number of ovals outside. Right, so A plus B has to be equal to 14, right? Because 15 ovals, because 16 is 15 is D minus 1 times D minus 2 over 2. Am I correct? Right? 15 is the triangle.
Oh, 14, not 15.
14 is not a triangular number, right?
No. A plus B should be 14.
A plus B is 14, yeah. Because one oval is already there, yes, thank you. This is 14, right? And then, so using this new patchworking technique, which was very efficient, Vero constructed all possibilities, all remaining possibilities, and he proved that the only thing which doesn't exist in this situation is that B cannot be equal to zero. So the only thing which doesn't exist and is not realizable by algebraic curves. It's not possible that there are 14 ovals inside of this oval and nothing inside. And everything else is realized. So this is still kind of rather short classification. For d equal to 8, I won't risk to try to give a complete classification here.
Did you say A equal to 0? This is not, no.
Here everything is known. It was classified by Vero completely. So the only thing which does not exist, right? So what exists is the following. So here I look at one pseudo line, I draw one oval, and then I have 14 more ovals. And those 14 more ovals I can distribute between the interior of this oval and exterior. And all distribution exists except for the only exception is that it's not possible to place all 14 ovals inside. There has to be one outside. So this was the classification in the degree 7 case. In degree 8 case, the classification is much longer. It was classified. So in degree 8 case, okay, already we have the next triangular number is 21 plus 1, so we have 22 ovals. And we have several nests, so there are kind of many already classifications. And if I'm not mistaken, I think in the algebraic case, it's also almost done by Arevkov. I think in the algebraic case, so in the symplectic case it was classified, and in the algebraic case, only three open questions, only three kind of arrangements for which it's not known whether they exist or not. So it's kind of feasible. So in this sense, it is almost classified. But if we kind of go even further, right? So already D starting from 9, there would be.
By the way, I have a question. So do you then like just assume this inequality is equality when you say, okay, D6, it's like, or D7 or D8, you just say there are 22 maximum.
Right, but so here I kind of restrict classification to M curves, which have maximum number of ovals. So again, for simplicity.
So the maximum number of curves are given by D minus one times D minus two over two plus one.
Exactly, yes. And actually it was observed already by Hilbert that this is in some sense more interesting case. Actually, it turns out, okay, experimentally, if you wish in some sense, that when the number of ovals is large, then there are many restrictions, like these four-dimensional restrictions discovered by Arnold and Rochlin, some other restrictions, very few things, right? Out of, for example, in degree 6, among all possible ways to arrange those 11 ovals, only three exist. However, if we radically decrease the number of ovals, then everything would be realizable. Kind of in the most extreme case, let's decrease it to three ovals. If it's kind of linear in terms of degree, then those three ovals, each of them we can realize by an ellipse, by a circle, and then place those circles or ellipses any way we want, and then consider just the product, the equation which is the product, and it would be singular curves. But if we perturb it a little bit, if we a little bit deform it, then it becomes smooth. However, the real curve is still the same, right? The homeomorphism type, if they didn't intersect in the real part, would still be the same. Right? So in a sense, when we have many ovals, this is, in a sense most interesting case.
Didn't mean Orekov's case resolves all cases with, if you look at the, you know, flexible curves. Just for those remarks for D equal to 7 and 8, right?
This is specific for degree 8, yes. So the technique which Arevkov was employing was that he was using those braids, those quasi-positive braids. And then actually, I think there was also a lot of computer power to classify those in degree 8, because one needs to see kind of those quasi-positive braids, they can give what kind of arrangements. So again, this is already in degree 8. My understanding that even in degree 8, it was a lot of competition.
So large degrees, his techniques doesn't give you all either.
It's not clear, at least I'm not maybe there is some general kind of algorithmic case, but well, it will have to correspond, at least I don't think so. I'm not sure. Okay. And no, maybe Ilya can. Do you know if there is some algorithmic kind of just answer whether something is symplectic kind of generalization of Stjepa's result?
No, I don't think so, because in principle, what he used in degree 8 is that well he needs to somehow to see the braids which are quasi positive, and in the case of braids with just three strings, it's well he did it, but when the number of strings is greater, it's not absolutely not clear how to do it algorithmically.
Although in degree 3, then probably he can do it in the case when it has a long enough nest, right? Probably something like this.
So yeah, for some particular cases like deep nests, probably it's possible, yeah.
Mm-hmm. I mean, quasi-positive case, there's a theorem of Rudolph, right? The day-bound complex.
Yes.
I think I was using other thing.
Yes.
Okay, but actually my point was that when the degree grows, that even if we restrict kind of to the most restrictive curves which we know so far, even if the number of components is the largest possible, even though it starts, it may start very nice in degree 6 when we only have 3 cases, it starts growing very rapidly, and actually it kind of number of types grows exponentially in terms of grows like the exponent of square of the degree. So actually it grows So even if by some chance we will give a complete classification for degree 8, then already for degree 9 there will be so many cases, then it would be almost impossible to do something. Okay, so here I'm coming to the point of this introduction, is that so can we find the kind of the most canonical or kind of the best arrangements there, best in some sense arrangements. And it turns out that there is such a way to kind of to restrict. So we know that just restricting to maximum number of components, this is not enough. They still grow very fast by the degree. Nevertheless, we can, there are some additional maximality restrictions, and this, which allows us to find a unique arrangement. So there is the best, in some sense, arrangement. So the answer is that there is the best arrangement, in some sense, the best arrangement. And there are many, there are several ways how to say that it is the best. From there is the topological, and there is this area properties, and those curves are known as simple Harnack curves. So in some sense, okay, the best, of course, this is something like our personal estimates, but there is a class of curves known as simple Harnack curves, and actually this is part of the curves which were constructed by Harnack in 1876. Not all of them, but some of them will have their properties. And in particular, if we go back to degree 6, right, when we had 3 arrangements for M curves, it turns out that this arrangement will also be maximal in some other senses, including some area considerations. And those two would not have this maximality properties. And then once we have this, there will be again, out of this many classification, out of this many arrangements of 15 ovals and one soidal line, there would be the best one. And actually, in this case, the best one would be just A equal to 0 and B equal to 14. So everything would be just 15 ovals outside without nest and so on. Then in degree 8, out of so many M curves, there would be unique, the best one over there, and all of them were known that they exist as kind of the best, they're also the simplest, and in some sense they were already constructed by Harnack in 1976. And now let me try to go back, try to answer. So before the definition, so kind of we need to say best in what sense. And here let us start our area considerations. And when we go back, let's go back to area considerations. Go back to area of let's say of a circle. When I say of a circle, I mean region inside the circle. Of course, circle itself is one-dimensional. So when we talk about this area of the circle, when we have this pi r square, this is the area which is Euclidean area, right? This is Euclidean area, and this is the area which comes from R2 as the Euclidean space. If we recall what did we do in 16 Hilbert problem, we kind of projectivized everything. Right? Once we're projectivizing R2 into RP2, RP2 is also a nice metric surface. Right? RP2 is S2 quotient by the involution of antipodal, by the antipodal involution. We identify the antipodal point. Nevertheless, it's still a surface of constant positive curvature. However, the area of those curves would be somewhat different, right? The same curve, that would be the area in this spherical RP2 would be different from this area of Euclidean RP2. But actually, so here is to have this maximality, so kind of jumping ahead, this strong maximality would be toric maximality, but we can also go we can go to and projectivize the thing, but alternatively, we can restrict to the torus. By the torus, I mean the real torus, real algebraic torus. So by this torus, I just mean R star square inside of R2. And this is just R2 minus the two axes. Minus the two axes. So in other words, so we have now our two coordinates, let's say x and y, and we have our ellipse. So the ellipse may be polygonal. This is not what I want. I can consider an ellipse like this. Right. And then now the question, what would be the area? What is the natural area inside of this R star square? And, but actually R star square is also, it's a group, right? R star square is a group. And it has a group invariant area. So the group under multiplicative translation and the multiplication by coordinates, and it and has multiplicative translation invariant area. Okay, so there are many things to say, but this area is simply the historic area dx over x, which dy over y, which is exactly the same thing as d log of x, which d log of y. So we do have this area. We have kind of somewhat different area. So here we have those logarithm map. And let us just consider the logarithm map. So consider logarithm map from R star square to R2. It just takes x, y to logarithm of the absolute value of x, logarithm of the absolute value of y. Right? This is a 4-to-1 map because we are dealing with the absolute values. And then our kind of toric area, our torus invariant area, is nothing but the area induced from the Euclidean area in R2, right? So Euclidean area here induces toric area. Right? So toric area is just, we're just using this for the measure. We're integrating this thing for the measure. And then once we have a curve like this, right? So how can I find the toric area of such curve? I can just take the image of this curve by the logarithm and then compute the area inside. What will I get? Yeah, it's a pity that I have. Maybe let me try to copy this picture. So I'll try to copy this picture because I want to have it on the same page.
You mean pullback area, right? From
between pullback, yes. So we have 4-to-1 covering, right? Some kind of trivial covering. So just four quadrants go to the same thing. We have stack of four half planes. And then the pullback of Euclidean area is now our toric area dx over x, which divide over y. Right? So I can compute kind of the area here, but I won't be using the area inside of this disk, right? Because if I try to compute the area inside of this disk, this logarithm goes to infinity, it will be minus infinity. Right? So instead of this, let's just take the image of this curve under the 4-to-1 covering. So let me try to draw it. So I'll draw it. Okay, so this was my curve. And the image in, so here will be log x and log y. It's kind of okay. So here, kind of, this is from minus infinity to plus infinity, right? What was from zero to infinity? And schematically, we can draw the image of this ellipse. Right? For example, here at this point, the value of x is zero, so the logarithm of x will go to minus infinity, while the logarithm of y will stay fixed. And so here I have kind of a tentacle inside of here. Then this part, which grows in here, is the image of this arc. And so this arc will go inside of here. The same thing we'll have here. We'll have here. And then this part will somehow correspond to this thing. And so the logarithmic image of this real curve is this region. It looks a little bit like amoeba, but the amoeba, as in the definition of Gelfand, Kapranov, and Zelevinsky, are images of the complex curve. So kind of mathematical amoeba will be something which will contain this. This is part of the amoeba. This is kind of the real amoeba inside. But what is interesting for us is that now we can take this area inside and measure. Right? So now this is the area inside. So this will be the area, logarithmic area log of our RC, our curve, if this was RC. Okay, and let's try to see some first properties which we have in here. If we recall, when we were doing the Euclidean areas of ellipses, circles, so all the areas could grow arbitrarily large. But it turns out that no matter what is the curve here, it's area inside of a corresponding curve is always finite. Finiteness is here easy to see just because of this the logarithm of the just we integrate the logarithm. So the area inside of those tentacles is finite. Right? Actually, this is easy exercise in calculus. But what interesting thing that actually the whole area is always bounded. So this area is bounded by the degree. So the area is always bounded by d square over 2 times pi square. So no matter how. Sorry?
I think I have a question.
Sorry, yeah. Mm-hmm.
So you said that on the left, no matter how big, so on the right, you have bounded. Exactly. All right. But then is there anything that you can measure? The array on the right gets bigger depending on the left picture? Gets smaller?
No. Okay, let's see, for example. Actually, here it's something which has the tentacles that goes to infinity. Let me consider slightly different situation when we don't have such things. So it will be maybe a little easier to see what's going on over there. So let me consider the case of just an honest circle. Right? We may have a circle, the circle of which we know that it's the area inside is pi r square. Right? So here I have this x, y. And I'm just considering the image of this circle by this map, x, y goes to log x, log y. So here I don't even have to take the absolute value because here I'm already taking the circle inside of the positive square, inside of the positive quadrant. Right? Okay, so the area of this circle won't be quite a circle. It will be slightly different. So actually I claim that it may already start having some triangular shape, but doesn't matter. We know that it's an image, some diffeomorphic image of a circle. So inside we will have some area. So here the area is pi r square. And here I say that there is always smaller than 2 pi square. And actually even strictly smaller. And we'll see what was going on. But let's see, why not? Let's see, for example, what happens if we take the homotheta? What happens if we change the radius, right? So if I apply the homotheta in this plane, inside of the logarithm, it will be translation. Translation doesn't change the size of this curve. Right? So this oval, if I use the homotheta, then this oval goes somewhere here. It kind of the big oval.
Homotheta is larger and larger concentric circles.
If we consider larger and larger concentric circles, yeah, this is a very good question. If we go larger and larger concentric, then one will start, it will start intersect the axis. And when it will start intersecting the axis, we will see those tentacles growing up. But then it turns out that the area of those tentacles again doesn't grow any further. So there will be the maximal most curve, and inside of cubic, the maximal most curve, the maximal area curve will be, let's say for d equal to 2. So this maximal area curve will be a hyperbola. Because actually, as you correctly say, to have it larger possible. So of course, it keeps the same area when we do homotheta, right? In just the translation. But if it's concentric, then it kind of, it being concentric, of course, it has to be slightly larger, right? Because once it is concentric, it will be larger and larger. But there will be some maximal possible area in every thing. And actually, this maximal arrangement of the oval is when it will be a hyperbola. And the hyperbola, which will be one branch would go like this and another like this. And this will just mean after the logarithm, that after the logarithm, what we have is the following thing. And inside the area, in this case, I claim that it, no matter what is the equation of the hyperbola, if it is algebraic equation, the area will be exactly 2 pi square. And it cannot be any larger than 2 pi square.
It doesn't, okay. It doesn't depend on R.
But here there is already no R actually. To make it really maximal, I have to move this concentric surface. So actually it will be larger and larger when it will be closer to those axes. But I also have the absolute, right? I also need to make to move it close to the absolute.
How people prove that like this area always less than 2 pi square?
Okay, we can prove it and actually prove it. This is my theorem from 2000.
sorry.
But I mean, we can go back to this. But so far, we are just kind of postulating some maximal properties of those curves. And actually, this will be kind of jumping ahead a little bit. This will be what we'll call the simple Harnack curves. Right. And actually, they will be maximal in terms of the area. They will maximize the area. Anything else will be strictly smaller than 2 pi square. Okay, maybe, okay, so I have about 10 minutes. So we can now make a definition of a simple Harnack curve. So one definition of simple Harnack would just mean that the real curve. So by definition, so it will be the real curve, will be a real curve. With of degree d with area log c equal to pi square over 2 d square is called simple Harnack. And any other curve, so there is this inequality, so any other curve will be strictly smaller than this. So in this sense, it is maximal from the area considerations, but actually one can show that it will also be maximal in many other respects. So one of the question is this, so the first question, does this curve have to be non-singular? Does it have to be smooth? So, right, I can consider this area even in the case if I have a smooth curve. Right? So for example, if I have the oval which is degenerated to a point, then it is just have area zero, so it's not maximal. And turns out that the answer is no. Actually, I'm sorry, I kind of cheated when I was giving this definition. So.
I'm sorry, can I ask a question?
Sure, yeah.
Does this curve exist for any degree?
Yes. Like,
and is it obvious or not?
No, it requires construction.
I don't understand why.
But in the case of P2, the construction can we can use the construction given in 1876 by Harnack. One can also generalize the notion of such curves to other toric surfaces. And in such case, the construction of such curves was given by Ilya Eitenberg and Alek Vero using patchworkness. So there are some. So construction one need, but actually there are. They have many nice properties. So one of the nice properties, very important one, that they exist. But another one is that they, in some sense, they are unique. Actually, we'll maybe see a little later, that the deformations are very easy to describe. Okay, well, let me, since I don't have too much time, let me finish. So that this curve has to be non-singular. And because you know, And in some sense, most interesting curve. So furthermore, the most singular curves. So we'll go to one of the to a special case of this proof in the case of P2, when Harnack also this was more singular curves are the easiest to describe. And actually, so first let me do it in the case of degree two, this description. So in the case of degree two, of course, if it's really singular curve, then it would have to have a point, and the point has area zero. So definitely not Harnack, because it has to have area 2π². Nevertheless, it may be singular in terms of its intersection with the axis. And so it may happen that here we have tangency, here we have tangency, and then kind of its restriction to one of the axes will be. So it is singular in the sense of Gelfand, Kapranov, Zelewinski in terms of the discriminant, determinants, and so on. Tangency with the absolute, tangency with that line would mean that this is a parabola. So kind of the most singular curve, which in degree two case is not singular, is a parabola. But such a parabola is easily constructed from a line. So I can consider this line, for example, x plus y equals to 1. And consider it so much under the map xy goes to x squared, y squared. So kind of the most singular Harnack curve can be constructed in this way. So we will prove at least existence of such curve with the given equality, but probably we'll leave the proof that indeed we have this estimate until one of the future language. Let's see that here, if I look at the logarithmic image, then what we get is a very well-known configuration. So if I write x plus y equals to 1, then it's very easy to just parameterize what happens in its logarithmic image. So the logarithmic image will be just given by curves. Here we have y equals to logarithm of 1 plus e to the x. Here we have x is equal to the logarithm of 1 plus e to the y. And here we have e to the x plus e to the 1 y equals to 1. And so we have those three things. And actually, I claim that the area here is area of this curve is equal to π² over 2. And actually, as was remarked by Passara, it can be related to Euler's formula zeta of 2 equal to π² over 6. And a new proof can be given and proved through such curves. Yes. So Mikhail Passara suggested a new nice elementary proof of Euler's formula based on looking at the area of such things at amoebas and coamoebas. So here to see, so I claim that the area is π² over 2, and this area has three parts, which are almost the same, right? So here, this part is...
what's the symbol? Zeta 2 or Zeta 2 what?
Zeta 2 is by definition is this Riemann zeta function, right? This is that zeta function which in quantum informatics people like to prove this zeta Riemann zeta conjecture. And so this is the zeta from the Riemann. This is the Riemann zeta function, right? This is the sum of its value into the just sum of 1 over n squared. And actually, it's easy to see, right? Because I can just integrate this part. So if I subdivide this part as x, this part as y. So if I just look, so the easiest thing is just compute this part in the negative quadrant. In this part, if we just write down the Taylor series and integrate, we'll get this sum over 1 over n squared, which is by definition the Euler formula. And so what Passara has noted, that the area of the amoeba can be related to the area of the argument image, what he called the co-amoeba, which is the torus, right? The area of the torus is 2 pi times 2 pi is 4 pi square. And then in this case, exactly 1/8 of such thing of this torus is occupied by this. And in any case, this is pi square over 2. And therefore, when we take the x square y square on the logarithmic plane, it's just doubling, right? So then if I go back and look at this amoeba of this singular Harnack curve in degree 2, then this is just the homothetic image of the same line. So this is amoeba, but twice as big. Right? Just because we're using the square, right? In logarithmic plane, it's just homothetic by 2. So the area here would be four times pi square over 2, which is 2 pi square, and so on. So more generally, we will get, we can look at a line. X plus y equals to 1. And then we can just look at the map xy goes to x to the power of d, goes to the power of d. Then we will get here tangencies of high degree. For example, let's consider now, so here I will draw d equal to 3 case. So in the d equal to 3 case, my curve will have inflection points here. And then it turns out that there will be a singular point, which will be not an image of any real point in here, but will be an image of two of a pair of conjugate points, which goes to here. And this will be a singular cubic, which is simpler Harnack. And more general, so in general, the resulting curve is like this. Actually, if I draw my RP2 in general for even degree, so what we'll have, so here, this is the schematic picture where I have the x-axis, the y-axis, and the infinity, right? So this is the y-axis, this is the x-axis, and this is the infinity axis, which I just drawn symmetrically because they correspond to three homogeneous coordinates for this polynomial. So the image of the line would be this even d. So there will be this contact of degree d, tangencies of degree d. Inside, so this is d equal to 2k. Inside there will be k minus 1 times k minus 2 points. And outside there will be k times k minus 1 points. So here I will have k times k minus 1 over 2 points. Here I will have k times k minus 1 over 2 points, and here it will be also k times k minus 1 over 2 points. But inside there will be somewhat less number, k minus 1 times k minus 2 over 2. So everywhere it's a triangular number, but here the triangle will be the next one. There will be 3 like this. And once we will perturb each of these isolated points to an oval, we will get a smooth M curve. And this is how we look at the obtained this simple Harnack curve. For example, after perturbation.
Sure, I missed. What is this picture? What are those points correspond?
These are singular points. They're usual nodes. Locally, x squared plus y squared is equal to 0. So just double points where two conjugate branches meet.
So this thing is the image of something else, right?
Right. Yeah. These points. So here, when we look at this point, x and y goes to x to the power d, y to the power of d, we have images of the real point. They become real, but also some complex points become real. Right? It might happen that x and y are not real, but some dth root of real unity, but the image is real. And those points
are from second picture to third picture, the picture on the right, the top to the lower picture. Yes. So what happened?
So this was the case, this was the picture d equal to 3. And here I'm just drawing the picture when d is even, d equal to 2k. For example, I can do it d equal to 4. Right? What will happen if d equal to 4? If d equal to 4, here I will have a tangency of degree 4 instead of inflections. Here will be tangency of degree 4. And then kind of at infinity, I will also draw it at finite distance to have a degree 4. And then here I will have this point, which comes from a pair of complex conjugate points. Here will be a point like this, and this will be this, once I perturb each of the oval, I would get this degree 4, this quartic, which is an M quartic. So after perturbation, when each singular point goes to the point, let me maybe finish my the first lecture with the degree equal to 6 case to go back to kind of the most classical Harnack curve. If we get d equal to 6, then we have the point in here. There will be exactly one point inside like this, and there will be this 3 points on each quadrant. And this will be this simple Harnack curves of degree 6. So these curves, the point which I wanted to make, that these curves satisfy to many maximal properties, many extremal properties. They are very nice. They have also some topological properties. And in some sense, once we restrict only to those curves, they give a solution to Hilbert's 16th problem to one topological type in every degree. But of course, it's in a sense cheating. It's replacing of the projective setting with the toric setting. Nevertheless, in the toric setting, they give a complete answer to this question. So maybe let me stop. Sorry for going a little bit over 1 hour.
Okay, let's thank our speaker. We will have questions. So, So if anyone has any questions, feel free to, we can just continue discussing.
So let me ask about the logic again. You arrived here from something on the left, right? You started some curve on the plane, and you deform this any way which way you want, and then you look at the image, logarithmic image, right?
Right.
So there's no, you could have deformed crazy ways on the left, right?
Right. It's also possible to deform these singular points so that all the points disappear. Actually, the construction through this taking the power was one particular way to construct it easily, but to construct singular curves. There are other constructions. For example, in the 19th century, the construction which was used by Harnack himself, So Harnack was the first to arrive to such curves with maximal number of ovals, and he was using kind of repetitive addition of a line and then perturbation. So there are several ways of constructing them.
I see. So you are drawing parameterized version of these curves, starting with the simplest one, line, image of line, by the 3D map, right? Parameterization, and then yeah. Draw the picture on the right.
Right.
I mean, what you start is very simple line on the left.
Exactly. Yes. So starting from a line, and actually, maybe I should say one other thing, that actually this curve is very easy to construct. And then just as the image of line, right? Because line is easy to construct, its image is also easy to construct. But also what was shown, maybe I should mention work of Kenyon and Okunkov. And this is that the deformation that the all. So there is kind of parameterization. So they parameterized simple Harnack curves. By log area of ovals. So this means that in this sense, in the parameterization, this curve is the zero coordinate, is when the area of all ovals except for this kind of special one is zero. And then what they showed, we can just specify, we can ask for any possible area. So not only that I can perturb the point to a circle, but I can ask for any area I want. For example, I want area one here, area two here, area five here, and so on. And there will be a unique curve up to a multiplicative translation, which will satisfy to this property.
I'm sorry again, when you parameterize this this curve, this line, you draw something. But where's the amoebas coming? When did you go to logarithmic chart in here?
Yeah, I also lost that part.
Ah, logarithmic chart, we didn't go here at all. In logarithmic chart was also to mention, because my definition of the simple Harnack curve was that they maximize the area.
I see. So the discussion below doesn't have any logarithmic chart. It's just a straight image under this map.
Well, it's kind of polynomial image. We take the power of each coordinate, but in logarithmic coordinates, it's just stretching, right, by d. So of course, if I have something of area pi square over 2, if I stretch every coordinate in d times, I have d square times pi square over 2. And if we believe to this theorem that any area has to be smaller or equal than pi square of d square over 2, we know that this is the maximum, right? Because we are constructing here the maximal possible area. So this particular thing we construct, and then we separately have to prove that any other curve cannot have larger area than it has to have smaller area.
So you are in below, you are describing your Anas paper, right? You once wrote the paper, here, middle one. And below, you go under, below of this. Go now, other way.
Okay, so the paper...
remember this picture in your Anas paper.
Right, so the theorem was that once we have this additional maximality, then there is unique configuration. Exactly, yes. I'm describing this theorem. But then, But in the beginning, it's also kind of a little bit new result, but maybe we'll discuss it.
Will there be any exercises for these talks?
Okay. Maybe as for the exercise, how about this proof, this beautiful observation of Passare? Let me go back to this area of, not here. right, prove Euler's formula. And prove Euler's formula, so the first part of the exercise, okay, let me try to write down. So exercise, which is essentially based on Passara observation. Michael Passara. If I look at this part, which is one third of the amoeba, right? So let me consider the following region in the plane, region bounded by e to the power of x plus e to the power of y is equal to 1, right? When x and y are negative. Actually, maybe to make it simpler, let's make it positive. Yeah, that doesn't really matter, right? So I just will make a translation. Right? So let's make it positive. Of course, nothing would change. So let me consider this curve given by the equation e to the power of x plus e to the power of y equals to 1, and x and y are positive. Right? Then we have the area underneath this curve in the positive quadrant. So first part, which is just a calculus computation, prove that the area of this region is pi square over 6. And second part, 1 and 2, is prove, so look at, so prove that the image of log of z plus w equals to 1 as a curve inside of c star cube. So here we're looking at complex solutions of this linear equation. So I'm taking the logarithm of this.
Sorry, you said cube, but you wrote 2.
What, where?
C star cubed?
Oh no, C star squared, yeah.
Right.
So just prove that the logarithmic image is bounded by the following curves. So here is e to the x plus e to the y. Equals to 1, x and y are negative. Then here we have y equals to 1 plus e to the x, and x equal to 1 plus e to the y. And so we have this thing. And deduce from 1 that the area here is pi square over 2. And so here we have 3 regions. As a hint, we just divide into these 3 regions of the same area. They are very symmetric. They have the same area. So we have pi square over 6, pi square over 6, and pi square over 6. And the third is that prove that the argument of z plus w plus 1 inside of R quotient by 2 pi z square in the torus is here I have from 0 to 2 pi. So here we have everywhere but the negative part, which means that this area is this region. Sorry, not 0 to 2 pi, minus pi and pi. Here a different one. Minus pi and pi at this coordinate. And also minus pi and pi at this coordinate. So I'm just taking, again, the image of this point. So argument here. So argument. W goes to arg z arg w. So I'm just every point goes to the argument. Then kind of clearly the area of each triangle is the area of the whole thing is okay, this is the third one. Okay. It will be
zero. The
this is the coamoeba, yes. This is the coamoeba as defined by Passer and Zich. And the fourth part, identify each of the two triangles in 3 with the region in 2, so 2 is this region, with the region in 2 by an area preserving diffeomorphism. What I mean, the interior of this triangle, right? The interior of each of this triangle can be identified with this interior of this region, with the interior of this amoeba. And I claim actually, so kind of as a hint to identify, I can, if I have an image of a point here, if I have a point here, the point here is mapped by the logarithm to this part and by the argument to this part. And this gives diffeomorphisms between interior of those two regions. So the exercise is to show that it preserves the area. And the fifth part is deduce Euler's formula from 4. The Euler's formula is zeta of 2 is equal to pi squared over 6. Well, here the area is, of course, of each one is pi squared over 2. So this is kind of clear that this is pi squared over 2, because here we have the square 2 pi by 2 pi. This is square pi by pi. Each triangle is pi squared over 2. And this pi squared over 2, if we know that it preserves the area, here, this region is also pi squared over 2. And therefore, one part, one third of this thing is pi squared over 6. And if we know that if we just compute by integral of the Taylor series of this thing, we will get just the expansion into 1 over n squared. So what Mikhail Passara noticed that this Euler formula can be deduced from noticing that this pi squared over 6 is one third of one of this triangle. And one third because this triangle gets reparametrized into this amoeba picture, and one third of this corresponds to the zeta of 2. Okay, so this is the whole series. Sorry, maybe it's too long, but part of this series, we will return to it in the next lectures.
Grisha, are these kind of calculations contained in your book with Ilya?
Say it again, sorry.
Are these kind of calculations contained in your book with Ilya?
I don't think so. You mean this with Ilya and Zhenya Shustin, right? This political. I think probably not, because these are there were maybe actually.
We have it in our.
Yeah, in this lecture, so in this lecture notes, probably there are some calculations with so of areas of amoebas, but probably not this calculation.
Not this. Because it's a kind of error, well, non-Archimedean amoebas, yeah, probably. I think not.
We have that book in our library. I was hoping I can read it. There's some simple calculations there. Anyway, are there any other place written source that we
actually
have?
For this part, so for the exercise part, this is a very nice observation by Mikhail Passar, and I think he had a paper for not even in the journal, not even in this AMS publication, but in the Math Association of America, which is more pedagogical, because it's kind of really. So there is a paper in, I don't remember, there's some journal of MAA, Mathematical Association.
Yeah, I
can find the link of this. So there's this kind of just a
paper by you and Ilya and what?
The paper by Mikhail Passara.
Passara, okay.
All right.
Grisha,
we're going to.
Sorry, Grisha, for the first part of the exercise, since you moved everything to the positive quadrant, you should probably replace x and y by minus x and minus y.
You're absolutely right, of course. Yeah. Thank you. Otherwise, it would diverge.
Otherwise, the curve is empty.
all right, so we will stop recording now. And.